Amen. Thankful to be here tonight. Amen. I'm thankful that my God is enough. Amen. I might as well, I'd rather just give Miss Susie my time slot. Amen. And let her go a few more minutes. Praise the Lord. I'm thankful that we serve a living Savior. Amen. I'm thankful he's on the throne tonight. Amen. And that he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. I'm thankful that's the God that I serve. Amen. And I'm thankful that he loves me enough to care for me. Amen. If you have your Bible tonight, I'm going to be in the book of Matthew, chapter number 8. And if you're one like myself, I like to be prepared for what's coming next. We will move on here and just momentarily to Matthew, chapter number 14. And I'll conclude in the book of John, chapter number 20. But I just want to give you a little bit of encouragement tonight and something that's helped me here in the past few months. I've gotten some help from the Word of God. Amen. I'm thankful for when the Word of God is able to help me. Amen. There's been times in my life that I've searched for an answer and I've picked up a book and I've read cover to cover and it didn't give me what I needed. There's been times in my life that I've got on tutorials on YouTube and I spent countless hours trying to figure out of what is ahead of me and it didn't give me the answer that I was looking for. There's been times that I've looked on the TV and watched documentary after documentary searching for the direction that I need to go in. I wasted days and days and days. I went to men and I went to family and I went to friends trying to get some counsel and guidance, but man, wasn't enough to give me the help that I needed. But this evening, I want to take us through the scriptures of when just only one word was enough to give you the help and the guidance and the direction that you need, when God in heaven could get along with you and give you one word. And it would answer any question. It would solve any problem. It would give you the direction of any time of day. And starting here in Matthew chapter number 8, I want us to take a look at a situation that's going on. And hopefully I don't lose my mule this evening. Amen. I want to be obedient to the clock time and here and everything. But preacher, I'm thankful for this opportunity. Anytime I stand behind a pulpit, I don't want to take it for granted. Amen. The book of Matthew chapter number 8, we'll begin reading in the verse number 28. And the Bible says, and when he was come to the other side into the country of the Gergesenes, there met him two possessed with devils coming out of the tombs exceeding fierce, so that no man might pass by that way. And behold, they cried out, saying, what have we to do with thee, Jesus, thou Son of God? Art thou come hither to torment us before the time? And this world likes to pretend that God ain't real. Atheists like to pretend that there's not a true king. But even the devils and demons of hell knew who this man was as soon as he stepped foot on scene. Amen. They said, what are you going to do with us? And verse 30, the Bible says, and there was a good way off from there a herd of many swine feeding. So the devils besought him, saying, if thou cast us out, suffer us to go away into the herd of swine. And listen to this tonight. I hope you can grab a hold of it and cling on to this. In verse 32 it says, and he said unto them, read it with me, go. And I see a period. I don't see a comma. I don't see another word following that. I see go, period. One word. And in this one word I see just a few things. And I'll give you this evening, number one, this word is a powerful word. Let us not forget that, amen? This word go is a powerful word. What do you mean, Colton? I see. Why is it a powerful word? Number one, because it's a demand. Amen? When God says something, he means it. Amen. When he says he's going to do something, he's going to do exactly that. When he says he's going to do something, he'll do it when he wants to do it. Amen. But when God says something, praise God, he means it with everything in him. Amen. And I'm thankful he said to these devils of hell, go. And they didn't have a choice but to get up and get out of town. Amen. It was a demand. I see not only was it a demand, but I see that there was deliverance. I see that these demons, they got up and they left these two men who were once possessed. Amen. Their chains were broken. Their chains were gone. They were once possessed by these demons of hell. But once God spoke the word, go, them demons fled and they got up out of there. And I'm thankful those men were set free. They were delivered. Amen. I'm thankful for the power in just that one word. Go. Listen, Oprah Winfrey, she writes books, but she can't do nothing like that. Amen. Dr. Phil, he's got plenty of time slots on the TV throughout the week, but he can't do nothing like that. Amen. Praise the Lord. Benny Hinn likes to fool us every now and then. Amen. But he don't got the power to say go, and then demons leave. But I understand we've been on a high note here, but I want us to get real. And we're living in the 21st century, and we're just a bunch of spoiled little brats. Amen. He done said it. Oh, my goodness. It got quiet. Let's continue reading what the Bible says here at the end of the chapter here in this last verse. It says, and behold, the whole city came out to meet Jesus. And when they saw him, listen to this, they besought him that he would depart out of their coast. I see that there was a demand from Jesus to them demons to go. These men were delivered from these demons. But they ain't like a bunch of 21st century Christians and followers of Christ that once God answers the prayers that we've been praying for, we say, okay, you go on your way. God, I've been praying for this house, but now that you're giving it to me, I think I'll just watch from YouTube instead of going out to church. Hello? God, I've been praying for this brand new car, but since you've given it to me, I think I might skip out on Wednesday night service. Hello? God, I've been praying for months and months and months and months that you would heal this cancer. But God, now that you've done it, I think I'll just set on this testimony. These people, you know what they saw? They saw Jesus Christ, the Son of God, cast demons out of two men. But you know what they were complaining about? You done killed all these pigs. We lost all our pigs. Church, this evening I see that there is power when my God speaks one word. Matthew chapter number 14, I got to move on quickly this evening. Matthew chapter number 14, I see another scenario when Jesus speaks just one word. And the Bible says here in verse number 22, we'll begin reading. The Bible says, and straightway Jesus constrained his disciples, this is after the feeding of the 5,000, to get into a ship and to go before him unto the other side. And while he sent the multitudes away, and when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up into a mountain apart to pray. And when the evening was come, he was there alone. But the ship was now in the midst of the sea, tossed with waves, for the wind was contrary. In the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went unto them, walking on the sea, and when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, it is a spirit, and they cried out for fear. I see a few things here before I tell you. We've looked at a powerful word, but I want us to take note here and put ourselves in the shoes of these disciples, these men who have walked and talked with Jesus. This was a time in their life that there was darkness. The Bible uses the terminology in the fourth watch of the night, and you study that out. And that is the darkest time of night. It was so dark that I tried to imagine they possibly couldn't even see the fella sitting next to them. They didn't know what direction they were going in. They didn't know what was in front of them. They didn't know what was coming next. Not only was there a darkness, but it says that they were in the midst of the sea. They were right smack dab in the middle. So not only darkness, but there was a distance. They were so much far away from Jesus this way as they were this way, and they had to make up their mind of what way they were going to go. And to beat it all, here we read that there was also a delusion. They looked afar off and they saw this being. They said, it's a spirit. They didn't even know who Jesus was. May I proclaim tonight that I never want to find myself in my life, whether it's so dark or I found myself so far away from the will of God, to not know who my Savior is. I don't want that darkness to be so dark that I don't know the presence of God. I don't ever want to be far enough from God that I don't know who He is. Church, this evening, can I give to you? We've seen a powerful word, but may I present to you a peaceful word. Let's read what the Bible says. In verse 28, and Peter answered him and said, Lord, if it be thou, bid me to come unto thee on the water. And Jesus said this, come. Amen. Oh, I'm thankful for the scripture. Yeah. Just one word. I'm thankful for the promises. He says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Amen. I'm thankful what he says. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. I'm thankful for the promises. It says, draw nigh to God, and he will draw nigh to you. I'm thankful for February 17th, 2001, when I heard the peaceful voice of God say, Colton O'Brien, it's time to come on home. Come on, come on, come on. I'm thankful for that power in just one word. And lastly, in the book of John, chapter number 20, and I will conclude this evening, and we look here at just a few verses of scripture, starting in verse number 11. The Bible says this, but Mary stood without the sepulcher weeping, and as she wept, she stooped down and looked into the sepulcher, and she had two angels in white sitting, the one at the head and the other at the feet where the body of Jesus had lain. And they say unto her, woman, why weepest thou? And she saith to them, because they have taken away my Lord, and I know not where they have laid him. And when she had thus said, she turned herself back and saw Jesus standing, and knew not that it was Jesus. And Jesus saith unto her, woman, why weepest thou? Whom seekest thou? She, supposing him to be the gardener, saith unto him, sir, if thou have borne him hence, tell me where thou hast laid him, and I will take him away. Now look up at me. Don't spoil it for the rest of us tonight. I want us to take a look and put ourselves in the shoes of Mary and understand that two angels had just got done talking to her, and I see that she was in a moment of doubt, because I don't know about you, but if some angels came and talking to me and telling me what I needed to do, or they were answering a question I had, or they were giving me some guidance to the direction I ought to be going, I don't know. I don't know what I would do, but here Mary, she had a little bit of doubt. How do you say that, Colton? Because even though these angels were here to give her comfort and possible direction and an answer to the question that she had, she continued to question. I see some doubt. Not only doubt, I see some depression. It tells us over and over that she's weeping and crying and weeping and crying and weeping and crying. May I say this even before I conclude? If you're living your life without Jesus, if you're living your life without Jesus, your life is going to be full of constant doubt and depression. But I'm thankful. I'm thankful. Blessed is the way of the man that walketh in the counsel. You help me out. I'm messing up. Church, what I'm trying to say is you will only find delight in that of the way of the Lord. Amen. You will only find true delight in Jesus. In verse number 16, it says this, and Jesus saith unto her, Mary. Just one word. In church, we've taken a look at a powerful word. Taking a look at a peaceful word, but I thank God for a personal word. I thank God that I serve a God that wants a personal relationship with me. He knows the amount of hairs on my head. He knows the thoughts going through my mind. He knows the desires of my heart, and he wants to know me. I sure am thankful for the troubles and trials of life that we serve a God who has the power to speak one word, and he can help you.